Good morning, Grace St. Paul's. Welcome to the fourth Sunday after Epiphany and annual meeting Sunday. Yay! I guess that wasn't very, very strong, was it? Yay! Okay. All right. So we will have our annual meeting starting at noon. After the service, we will have food outside for you after the service. And also, immediately after the service, vestry, we're hanging around here because we have to approve a couple things before the meeting starts. So vestry, if you'll hang out here, but everybody else, go get some food and come on back for annual meeting. I think most of you know that we're also Zooming the annual meeting, and you can vote in person or Zoom. It's a lot easier if you're here, but we've got everything figured out, I'm sure. So we're in good shape. So that'll be great. So the Zoom address is in the e-blast. It's also in your bulletin. Should be very easy to sign if you're headed home for annual meeting. But if you can stay, that'd be great. All right, food outside. So we have lots of voting to do today. We'll be voting for vestry members. We have four vestry members to choose, five diocesan convention delegates. We have a treasurer transition happening. We have a potential junior warden transition happening that will be up to you guys. And we have a bylaw change and lots of stuff to report on and tell you about all the exciting things that are happening here. So that is today at noon, okay? So we'll see you here for that. Giving and receiving, we are up to $526,000. So we had another little jump up this week. Thank you all. Thank you very much for that. 575 is the goal, and we'll talk about that in annual meeting, of course, and what we're going to do financially and all that fun stuff, too. All right. We would like you all, we have a few paper copies of the annual report, but we would prefer that you download the annual report if you can, and you download it before we start the meeting, okay? Because we don't want to use all that bandwidth during the meeting because we have so many people online, okay? So if you can do that before the meeting, that's great. It's right on the website, right when you go on and list happenings at GSP. I think the second thing is the annual report. So if you can just download it, that'll be great, but we will have a few paper copies too, okay? So thank you for that. Angel Wong has asked me to remind you all that we are still looking for a few Creation Care Committee members. As you all know, Creation Care is front and center here at Grace St. Paul's, so talk to Angel about that. Angel's right here in front, maybe. Thank you, Angel. Thank you. All right. good. Just a reminder about communion. Everyone is welcome to communion in this church, regardless of your faith tradition or where you are on your spiritual journey. We are doing communion in two kinds, but we are just intincting wine. So when you come up, I want you to give me a signal. One means you just want bread. Two means you want me to intinct your bread in the wine, okay? So there you go. That's all there is to it. Thank you for that. We talked about vestry. And I just heard that today is the fifth anniversary of David Wachter being on the bench. How about that? So, it seems like only yesterday, doesn't it? All right. Welcome all to the fourth Sunday after Epiphany. What does God require of you?
To do justice and to love kindness and to walk humbly with our God.
What does God command of us?
To love God with all our heart and all our soul and all our mind and all our strength, and to love our neighbor as ourselves.
God does not call us to ease or to comfort,
but to presence and abundance and grace in our struggle.
Let us worship the God who believes in us and trusts in us and abides with us.
Let us worship the God who will ask much of us, but will be beside us every step of the way.
May God be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. God, our deliverer, you walk with the meek and the poor, the compassionate and those who mourn, and you call us to walk humbly with you. When we are foolish, be our wisdom. When we are weak, be our strength, that as we learn to do justice and to love mercy, your rule may come as blessing.
A reading from Micah. Hear what the Eternal One says. Rise, plead your case before the mountains, and let the hills hear your voice. Hear, you mountains, the controversy of the Eternal One, and you enduring foundations of the earth. For the Eternal One has a controversy with his people, and he will contend with Israel. Oh, my people, what have I done to you? In what have I wearied you? Answer me. For I brought you up from the land of Egypt and redeemed you from the house of slavery. And I sent before you Moses, Aaron, and Miriam. Oh, my people, remember now what King Balak of Moab devised, what Balaam, son of Beor, answered him, and what happened from Shittim to Gilgal, that you may know the saving acts of the Eternal One. With what shall I come before the Eternal One and bow myself before God with high on high? Shall I come before him with burnt offerings, with calves a year old? Will the Eternal One be pleased with the thousands of rams, with the tens of thousands of rivers of oil? Shall I give my firstborn for my transgression, the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul? He has told you, O mortal, what is good, and what does the Eternal One require of you but to do justice and to love kindness and to walk humbly with your God? Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
Thank you. The Holy Gospel of our Savior Jesus Christ, according to Matthew.
Glory to you, O Christ.
When Jesus saw the crowds, he went up the mountain, and after he sat down, his disciples came to him. Then he began to speak and taught them, saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven. For in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you." The Gospel of Jesus Christ.
Praise to you, O Christ.
For every candid observer agrees that the Negro is happier and better as a slave than as a free man, and no individual belonging to the Anglo-Saxon stock would acknowledge that the intellect of the Negro is equal to his own. Amen. Please be seated. Don't run out of church yet. No, those are not the words of Kanye West or Tucker Carlson. I wish to heavens they were. I am ashamed to inform you that this is a quote from John Henry Hopkins, the first Episcopal Bishop of Vermont and the presiding bishop of our church from 1865 until his death in January 1868. He made that statement at the beginning of the Civil War. I would also love to tell you that this quote is an anomaly, but the unfortunate truth is that Hopkins wrote two books on the biblical justification of slavery. But perhaps the most damaging of all was the small tract he wrote called The Bible View of Slavery. In it, he argues that the Bible does not just fail to condemn slavery, but that it condones it. He states that its practice was accepted by all biblical leaders, including Jesus. Quizzically, the bishop also stated that he was personally against slavery and that he would be in favor of gradual abolition. But he quickly added that no one has, quote, any right to interfere with the domestic institutions of the South, either by law or by gospel, unquote. Hopkins seemed to intuitively understand that slavery was morally wrong, or at least that it hurt the white population that took part in that. He talked about that. But because he understood the Bible as sanctioning it, he felt that the church had no right interfering in the injustice. Okay. That was also the stand of the Episcopal Church in general. At the 1856 General Convention, they made no declaration about the violence that was going on in Kansas or whether it should be admitted to the Union as a slave or free state, stating it like this: the church should have, quote, nothing to do with party politics, with sectional disputes, with earthly distinctions, with the wealth, the splendor, and the ambition of the world, unquote. As I make clear every year in Episcopal 101, we were the only major denomination in the United States who had a strong presence in both the North and the South that did not split in half during the Civil War. Should we be proud of that? The Confederate bishops went so far as to send out a pastoral letter to the entire church during the war, stating that they had previously, quote, been hindered by the pressure of abolitionism. Now we have thrown off from us this hateful and infidel pestilence, unquote. Liberated from the infidels who wanted to end slavery, they could concentrate on the work of the church as they saw it, declaring slavery, quote, a sacred trust given to us by God, and then educating black folk about this God who proclaimed that their place in life was to be a slave. That's what is going on in today's first reading from Micah. Micah is a young contemporary of Isaiah, so he is speaking in the same period of time we talked about last week when the Israelites were being manhandled by the Assyrian Empire. What are the religious elites, the presiding bishops, if you will, suggesting should be done in response to the oppression they are facing? Follow the law of the Bible, they are told. Stand clear of the politics of the day. That is not the purview of religion. Our job is to do what the Bible tells us. So do worship right, sacrifice your best animals, use that oil of chrism to appease God, sacrifice your firstborn if you have to, because that is what is pleasing to God. Look, that's what it says right in the Bible. Do it right, do it properly, and all shall be well. And how does Micah respond to the John Henry Hopkins-like understanding of the role of religion? Really, folks? You believe that the way to end injustice and oppression is to worship better? Because our ancient ancestors understood their relationship with the Eternal One to be transactional, we should believe and do the same thing? Think about the ethics of sacrificing an animal or a human just for a second. Does that make any sense to any of you? God does not call us to follow a formula in a book. God calls us to protect life, not kill it. God calls us to stand up against evil, to tell the world about the injustices being perpetrated upon a people and upon our earth. God tells us to stand up for what is right, to scream out against iniquity and abuse. God doesn't care a flying flip about how you hold up a piece of bread during worship. God wants your worship to be a springboard out into the world so that you can make justice happen, so that you can show the world how to love and how to be kind. That is how you walk humbly with your God. Then, in that gospel you just heard, we listen to the first words in Matthew that Jesus offers after commissioning his disciples. Does he ask them and the crowds gathered to follow the law of the Torah? Does he tell us not to take a political stand when someone is being dishonored? Not exactly. He points out the very people who are being ill-treated by an exploitative society, that they are the ones that God honors. They are the ones that God blesses. God blesses the people being destroyed by society and the ones doing acts of justice to bring peace and liberation. We are called, Jesus teaches us, to care for them also and to stand up for them. We are people of justice. We are called to take the ethical stance, even when it may break up the structure of society or the church. Of course, it is not just this gospel where Jesus confronts the John Henry Hopkinses of his world. How many times do the Pharisees come to him, pointing out that he is disregarding the biblical teachings on a subject? How many times do they call him out for doing something contrary to Scripture? And Jesus' response is always the same. Religion is not about following a formula. You do not create the kingdom of God by making sure you do it exactly as our ancestors did. Things change. The world rotates. What worked 1,000 years ago may be helpful to us now, and it also might make no sense at all in our present situation. The spirit of the biblical law is what is important, and that is bringing justice to all. Doing something just because it says so in the Bible is just like the church heresy of our time. But we've always done it that way. We can't change. What really frosts my pumpkin, though, about people in our tradition blindly following excerpts from the Bible is that as Anglicans, we should all know better. Our church was founded on the theology of Richard Hooker, who, after the Protestant Reformation, began to articulate what it meant to be Anglican. He started with a theology of Martin Luther, whose rallying cry was so important in reforming the church. Sola Scriptura, the Bible only, was a vital correction necessary in a church that told everyone that the only way to salvation was through sacraments dispensed by a priest. How creepy is that? Your salvation would be based on my actions. That is really crazy. Telling folks that you don't need no stinking priest to connect with God, all you need is your Bible, was absolutely mandatory to address the atrocities occurring in the church. But Hooker also realized that our faith is not solely based on the Bible, that following that only would be sheer folly. He realized that to throw out thousands of years of church tradition was ludicrous. We have learned much from that ancient tradition, and it too informs us like the Bible does. But in response to the Roman church, Hooker said tradition also is not enough. He realized that we must apply one more leg to our faith. We need to use our heads. We need to think. We are a church of reason, beloved, and we must utilize all three of those resources, Scripture, tradition, and reason. And if we are going to faithfully live into our calling, we have to use them all. That is what it means to be Anglican. And Micah and Jesus offer us a tool today to verify our reasoning in determining what God requires of us. Does our action bring about justice or not? Is what we are about to do based in loving kindness or not? It's really pretty darn simple. Now, I understand the pressure the Archbishop of Canterbury is under right now. I really do. I know he is desperately trying to preserve the union, hold together all of the Anglican communion. But beloved, apologizing to the LGBTQ plus community for how they have been treated, as the Church of England did last week, while simultaneously affirming that no one can be married in a C of E church except heterosexual couples, is the height of hypocrisy. suggesting that there is a biblical justification to continue this ban is not only revolting and terrible theology, it is also totally un-Anglican. It is as harmful and abusive as what John Henry Hopkins did here in the 19th century. How is that loving kindness? What is just in any of that? I cannot believe we have to have this conversation all over again, but even if you were to stupidly argue this from only a biblical perspective, where does that take us? There are 8 references to homosexuality in the entire Bible. 8! How many references do we have to, let's say, money? Over 2,000! But even setting that aside for a moment, no reasonable person who reads those 8 passages could possibly think that any of them is referring to a same-sex monogamous relationship. That would be totally absurd. And of course, Justin Welby knows that way better than any of us. But here is how he explained his decision to the British press. Because of my pastoral care and responsibility of being a focus of unity for the whole communion, I will not personally use them, referring to same-sex blessings, in order not to compromise that pastoral care. Yeah, it's John Henry Hopkins all over again. The Archbishop of Canterbury has made this decision solely on what he believes is best for the church, regardless of how much it flies in the face of Micah and Jesus. Now, the lightning bolt has not come yet, so this is good. If the C of E really wants to respond with justice and loving kindness, they need to stop punishing the innocent and instead address the situation that got us into this mess. We all need to acknowledge that we are the ones responsible for the archaic theology being taught in parts of Africa because we are the ones who sent them our 100-year-old theology books and then wondered how they could come up with such outdated ideas. This is our fault, folks. We need to take that. Now, I am grateful that the Episcopal Church has had the courage to do justice, to love kindness, and to walk humbly with our God in recent years, refusing to follow the lead of the Mother Church. But it took us a really long time after the legacy of John Henry Hopkins to get there. Once that decision was made leading up to the Civil War to return to sola scriptura, whatever the Bible says goes, once we decided as a church not to rise up against the government when they were oppressing others, we stayed in that mode for the next century. Instead of being prophets and speaking out against the state when injustices occurred, we became a pawn of the republic. By the 1940s, Episcopalianism became the go-to religion of American politicians. Some of you remember those glory days. It was the religion of the elite of this country. Most importantly, for those running for office, it was the safe religion because we never took a stand for or against anything. And for those reasons, congressmen all became Episcopalians, remember? For these reasons, the period from 1946 to 1960 became the time of greatest growth of our church. All that came to a screeching halt when presiding Bishop John Hines saw the hypocrisy of a church that had turned a blind eye to the injustices of society. We finally moved out of our Bible-only mode and made the civil rights movement the central concern of this church. Hines called for reordering the church's finances to address the gigantic inequalities that have been created in American society. He said that he would consciously devote our efforts to black concerns. We stood up for empowerment and self-determination for African Americans across the board. We worked with Archbishop Desmond Tutu and pushed for American corporations to divest from South Africa, which would be the major factor in ending apartheid. By 1980, the Episcopal Church was voted the most active and concerned church on bringing about racial justice. Finally, we became the Church of Micah, the Church of Jesus. Then would come the push for equality for women in the church and in the culture. And as a result of those things, Southern Episcopalians left this church in droves. Then entire congregations left when we began ordaining women. And of course, that exodus from the church continued at warp speed when we began ordaining openly gay individuals. We lost our membership, our money, our power and prestige, and it was so wonderful. We lost it all because we became the real church. We began living into the Beatitudes. We began doing justice. We began living kindness, and we began walking humbly with the God who called us to bring dignity to all of God's people and all of God's creation. Beloved, there is never any question what we are called to do as the church. And it has nothing to do with using the Bible to justify injustice or to preserve the institution. We are here to comfort the afflicted and to afflict the comfortable. That is our job. Last Monday in our GSP Today session, I was urged by those present to not forget this. I was exhorted to not back down from the message of Micah and Jesus, to continue to prophesy to a corrupted and broken world, to keep speaking out against a church that often falls back into self-preservation mode. It is that encouragement and endorsement that gives me the courage to continue to speak truth to power. It is your willingness to be challenged to live into Micah's and Jesus's call that allows me to call us to the work of justice while so many others feel they cannot go there. I thank God every week for all of you. I thank God that I am not in Justin Welby's shoes, that I get to speak to a community willing to hear the message of justice and then do the hard work to live into our true calling. As we look to the future on this annual meeting Sunday, let us vow to always be the church that leads by example, to always be the church that comforts the afflicted and afflicts the comfortable, to always be the church that does justice, loves kindness, and walks humbly with our God, no matter what may happen to us as a result. Amen.
Let us say an affirmation of faith found on page 12. Jesus taught us to speak of hope as the coming of God's kingdom. True peace and true reconciliation are not only desired, they are assured and guaranteed in Christ.
This is our faith. This is our hope. Amen.
Now let us pray for the world and all that is in it, giving thanks for God's abundance.
God of light, who dispels the darkness from the earth, accept the gifts we bring and help us to receive the gifts of your Spirit. For kings, rulers, leaders, and all who are in positions of authority, we ask for your gift of justice and a hunger for righteousness so that peace will reign in human hearts and in the world.
God of light,
we thank you for the gift of peace that inspires us.
For the church and all who call upon your name, we ask for the gift of clear vision so that we can see and follow in your footsteps. We especially pray for all of the world's places of worship, that we may continue to find creative ways to end racism and to respond to hate with love.
Incarnate God,
thank you for the gift of incarnation that shows the church how to be real. For nature and all of your creation, we ask for the gift of grace and wisdom so that we know our place in your creation and respect its beauty, variety, and power. This week we pray that the cutoff of water to Rio Verde foothills outside Phoenix will awaken the West to the dire need to conserve.
Creator God,
we thank you for the privilege of being human.
For those who suffer and for those who are in need, we ask for the gifts of compassion and redemption so that we can be channels of healing. We especially pray for the people of Ukraine, including those in Russian prisons, for those on our prayer list, and for those we now name.
Redeemer God,
we thank you for the gifts of healing, forgiveness, and redemption. God of resurrection, we ask for your gifts of patience, comfort, and courage to all those who grieve. We thank you for the gift of eternal life and for those who have died. This week, we especially remember George Prager and those killed in Monterey Park and Half Moon Bay, as we continue to plead for a ban on all assault weapons.
We pray for the family of Tyree Nichols. God of eternity,
we thank you for the gift of saints and life that does not end.
For those we love and for all the earth, we ask for your gift of blessings. Help us to remember that suffering and hardships can also be blessings. This week, we give thanks for our annual meeting and the opportunity to share the good news of Grace St. Paul's, past, present, and future.
God of Epiphanies,
we thank you for the gift of journeys,
for stars to follow,
and for angels who accompany us along the way. empowering God when the road ahead looms endless. Inspiring God when the road forward is blocked. Enabling God when the road before us divides.
Let us confess our sins against God, our neighbors, and God's creation. People of compassion,
we are overwhelmed by the struggles of life. We hunger and thirst for righteousness, but find ourselves feeling empty. We grieve in seasons of loss, feeling hopeless and lost. We want to show mercy, but we hold on to old resentments. We want to make peace, but we don't even know where to begin. Come with your wisdom and guide us in your ways. Renew us and inspire us to live faithfully as you walk beside us. Amen. Beloved, Jesus speaks words of blessing to those who struggle, offering joy and gladness through the triune God each and every day. Amen. And may the peace of the Creator be always with you. Let us offer each other a sign of God's peace. For the Eternal One is a God of justice. Blessed are all those who wait for God.
Thank you.
giver of life, receive all we offer you this day.
Let the Spirit bestow on your church, continue to work in the world, through the hearts of all who
This morning we have our superstars up here with me, Lila and Nathan, because together we are all the body of Christ. God is with us.
God is present here.
Rejoice, lift up your hearts.
We lift our hearts to the Most High.
Let us give thanks to the Holy One.
It is right to offer thanks and praise.
It is truly right and just that we praise you, God of all, the ground of our being, the one who lovingly creates all that is. The Spirit comes to us today as we are commissioned to go forth and bring the good news. We welcome the Spirit who challenges us in new directions, who heals our wounds and gives us comfort in all our needs, who gives us renewed strength to become all that we can be. Together we say, come. Come and melt whatever is frozen. Bend what is stubborn within us. Be our guide along our journey. Give us joys that never end so that we too, along with all the angels and saints here with us today, will always sing your praises. And honor are yours, Creator of all. Your word has never been silent. You called a people to yourself as a light to the nations. You delivered them from bondage and led them to a land of promise. Of your grace, you gave Jesus to be human, to share our life, to proclaim the coming of your holy reign, and give himself for us a fragrant offering. Through Jesus the Christ, our Redeemer, you have freed us from sin, brought us into your life, reconciled us to you, and restored us to the glory you intend for us. We thank you that on the night before he died, Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his friends and said, Take eat. This is my body, broken for you. Do this for the remembrance of me. After supper, Jesus took the cup of wine, said the blessing, gave it to his friends, and said, Drink this, all of you. This cup is the new covenant in my blood, poured out for you and for all to set us free. Do this for the remembrance of me.
And so, remembering all that was done for us, the cross, the tomb, the resurrection and ascension, longing to embody Christ's glory, we acclaim you, O Christ.
Dying, you destroyed our death. Rising, you restored our life. Christ Jesus, shine in glory. We now present to you these gifts your earth has formed and human hands have made, as well as ourselves. Send your Holy Spirit upon us and upon these gifts of bread and wine, that they may be to us the body and blood of your Christ. Grant that we, burning with your Spirit's power, may be a people of hope, justice, and love. Giver of life, draw us together in the body of Christ, and in the fullness of time, gather us with Paul, Ansgar, Roger Williams, Anne Hutchinson, the martyrs of Japan, Cornelius the centurion, and all your people into the joy of our true eternal home. Through Christ and with Christ and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, by the inspiration of your Spirit, we worship you, our God and Creator, in voices of unending praise.
Blessed are you now.
Oremos como nuestro Salvador Cristo nos enseñó. Padre nuestro, que estás en el cielo, santificado sea tu nombre. Venga tu reino, hágase tu voluntad, en la tierra como en el cielo. Danos hoy nuestro pan de cada día. Perdona nuestras ofensas,
como también nosotros perdonamos
a los que nos ofenden. No nos dejes caer en tentación y líbranos del mal, porque tuyo es el reino, tuyo es el poder y tuya es la gloria, ahora y por siempre. Amén.
Alleluia, Christ is revealed in the breaking of the bread.
Therefore, let us keep the feast. Alleluia.
Beloved, this is the body of Christ, for the body of Christ. Be what you see, receive what you are.
Thank you.
Let us pray. The deeper the darkness, the brighter the light shines, for love refuses to be extinguished by despair. Resilience and hope cannot be quenched while the light of love burns steadily, fueled by courage and by compassion. We will look for the light, and there we will find love. Amen. Beloved, as you have been fed, go to feed the hungry. As you have been set free, go to set free the imprisoned. As you have been received, give. As you have heard, proclaim. And the blessing which you have received from the Creator, Christ, and Holy Spirit be always with you.
Thank you.
See you at noon.